in 1 year. We started the project in January last year, and in another in 1 year we've done 5,000. And this project does not cost much. If you look at the solar, it's about 220,000. That's 220,000 rupees. For that, the amount of impact that is made, I think, is pretty significant. So this project, I don't know if it fits into any sort of innovation or which of these definitions they fit into, but this is a project that's very close to a lot of us. These are some of those children who have touched computers for the first time. That's when I saw this disparity. So here I have my 3-year-old cousin who knows to operate everything on an iPad, and here we have 13-14-year-old children who are touching the computer for the first time. A lot of excitement that they have just by pressing start, by pressing minimize. That's the sort of gap that, you know, really needs to sort of get bridged. And I think for the children, there are so many more to go, and there's lots of work that we want to do on some things. Okay, so this is another project that is often termed as innovative again. So street vendors, you all know street vendors that sit on the street and sell maybe fruits, vegetables, flowers, etc. And they all have these kerosene lamps, these petromax kerosene lamps, and they put kerosene in them every day. They switch it on, say about 5-6 o'clock in the evening, and it runs about 9 or 10. So the business model for these street vendors are such that every day in the evening they put kerosene, into their kerosene lamp, and they run it. So every day they spend 15 rupees, and their cash flow is that they buy material worth 500, they sell worth 550, and 50 rupees is their profit, out of which maybe 50 rupees goes towards kerosene. So basically what I'm trying to say is that their cash flows are tight, which allows them to only pay on a daily basis. So when we went to them and said, you want a solar system, we'll help you with a bank, you can get an EMI, can you pay 300 rupees a month? They said, we can pay even 10 rupees a day, but we cannot pay 10 rupees a month. Right? So that again started startling us. We are not used to listening to how does it make sense. If you have 10 rupees a day, of course it has to. So again, the problem is they don't have access to reliable energy, because our banks chose to have a scheme that is suitable to most of us who draw our income at the end of the month, right? So how do we look at this a little differently? So what we did is we had one entrepreneur, local person who actually is part of that market. We had him to actually buy 20 systems. So he went to the bank and said, okay, I will buy 20 systems. I will put the panels at my house. I will recharge the battery every day. Evening, I take these batteries with a light and give it to these people on rent. So you are a street vendor sitting on the road today, and every day you spend kerosene. At that same cost or lower, you have somebody to give you an option of buying a solar light, right? So A, it is cheaper. B, it is more sustainable because you don't have those kerosene fumes. And C, you have even more customers coming in, because people prefer going to a shop that is well lit than a shop that is kerosene lit, right? So these are the sort of benefits that are coming up. And what have we done differently? There's no great innovation. All we have done is connect the dots differently. There is a bank, there is an entrepreneur, there are people who need it, and there's a solar provider. Just connecting these dots differently has helped take a product like this to these people. So this is the way that we set it on the start in the evening and puts it up. So on top of the apples, you see the light hanging, and below it keeps the battery. Every evening he takes it back. So this is just my last story on a program that we run that's called Light for Education. So when we looked at education and some of these government schools, we realized there have been a lot of dropouts simply because there is no motivation for them to pursue academics. And good part of that lack of motivation happens also because they're not able to complete their homework. They're not able to complete their homework also because they don't have reliable lighting in their house. So once they go back home, they probably are playing the sunsets, and then after that they want to get to do their homework, there's no electricity. And because of this, they don't do their homework, teachers are not happy, they believe academics are not good, and that's it. How do we try to look at this problem? Because not all the parents can afford to buy a solar system for their children. So we have a program where it's sort of piggybacked on this midday meal scheme, where you incentivize a child to come to school and provide light in the house. So I'll just explain that. So what we do is we put up solar panels at the school, and we give these children a lantern. And with that lantern, we give them a small portable battery that is probably as large as this, right? Which they can carry. them in their pocket and come to school every day. So what happens is that now you're incentivizing to go to school. When you go to school, you can charge it to bring them and that light shows that you can study and there's no reason for you not to complete your homework. So parents are also starting to push their children and saying, I want you to go to school, we are light in the evening, right? So we're creating this incentive mechanism for these children by just a simple innovation of how you detach a battery and keep a central charging station. So this program in fact has touched about 5,000 children today, and we are doing this in the last year in Karnataka, and it's seen some significant impact. And some of the happiest stories is when we hear people call us in March and April and say, in the entire village there were only 2 houses that had solar power, and both are the only children who have graduated.
We So now the ulterior motive of why we've been inviting you all, and that's we'd like to be our partners on this journey. In setting the center up, to understanding what it would do, whether it is students to think of students as possible interns, to think of this as an innovation center or for innovation activities, whether to think of places where technology can be developed and tried out, whether you think of new teaching models that you might be interested in. This is all up in the air. But think of us as where we hope to be able to recruit a wide variety of students from different backgrounds, different calibers. We're setting up the team with respect to our researchers and faculty who will work on those projects, who like to publish on it, who like to get interesting data, develop results on it. And of course, corporations such as teams that you lead and companies that you are partners with. Because that's the system that we hope to be able to create to give our students the opportunity to participate. So now I'm being candid and saying, our skin in the game. That's why we hope you're here. So, and we are quite serious about this. So, all of you in this room, we look forward to talking to you more, working with you more, understanding how we can collaborate, and hope you will think of MYRA as a connection with which you can get your accomplishments done, be it business, be it sustainability in a social context, be it just innovation the way you define it. So, thank you very much for coming. And this is not goodbye. We hope it's hello.
And the art of leadership. We view them as creative and powerful forces with the potential to improve India and the world. MYRA is proud to announce the launch of the Center of Excellence in Sustainable Business Innovations, which was inaugurated this afternoon by Dr. Ganeshan Balachander, Executive Director, Ashoka Trust for Research in Ecology and Environment, Bangalore. To talk about CESB, it provides an open platform for researchers, students, policymakers, corporations, academic institutions, and non-profit organizations. The center aims to facilitate and publish groundbreaking research that addresses today's challenges and defines tomorrow's problems. It creates opportunities for emerging and established business leaders to connect and collaborate, host international conferences and distinguished speakers to showcase regional and global developments and sustainable innovation. The formal inauguration today was followed by a workshop which brought together a panel of industry experts from various disciplines to discuss issues related to sustainability and business innovations. The speakers that included were Alex Densmore from Simpa Energy, Vishnu Swaminathan, Ashoka Innovators for the Public, Melissa Densmore from Microsoft Research, Momita Sen Sharma from Isha Foundation, Krishna Kumar from Cropin Technologies, Shivram Malavalli from eHealth Technology Business Incubator, and Nikhil Nair from Selco. I now introduce Dr. Abhinanda Sarkar, Associate Dean, MYRA School of Business. Dr. Abhinanda Sarkar, till recently, was Principal Scientist, Software Sciences and Analytics in GE Global Research, Bangalore. In this role, Abhinanda worked with GE research and engineering teams as they designed software and solutions built around data mining, modeling, and optimization. Abhinanda's publications and patents have been in applying statistical and probabilistic methods to areas such as wind energy forecasting, bond market analytics, biomedical text mining, content-based image retrieval, wireless network interference, and gravitational wave detection. Dr. Sarkar received an M.Tech M.Stat degree from the Indian Statistical Institute and his PhD in statistics from Stanford University, USA. We welcome you, sir. I now request Dr. Abhinanda Sarkar to welcome and introduce the speaker, Professor Vijay Govindrajan.
Accomplishments get you to Harvard Business School and other places, from where he received his MBA with distinction and received an award and doctorate. Since then, his research has spanned both academic as well as practical business implications. There aren't too many academic researchers who receive recognitions from both their peers in the academic rigorous research foundations of their subjects, be it accountancy, innovation, etc., as well as get many award-winning publications in the Harvard Business. For example, to say that this is actually useful, this is how companies work, and this is how we should be doing it. Given that, he was recently ranked number 3 on Thinkers 50 list of the world's most influential business thinkers. And that's ahead of Jim Collins. And that's ahead of It's indeed a pleasure to have you here. Sir, your books have been widely recognized in a variety of forums, and you've written all across the innovation spectrum. Some years ago, from my own history, I mean, around 2005 in GE, we were trying to do a project in biomass. So what we were trying to do is we were trying to say that in India, we can set up power plants that can run on biomass and do it effectively. We ran into a problem. And the problem was that the power pack needed to be smaller to run in these operating conditions for the grid and other reasons, and that we needed to have a far more sophisticated gas cleanup system so that we could deal with, for example, rice husk and silica, etc. So we saw the technology specifications in research using software hardware solutions, and we went to GE management and said, we want to sell this because people really want it and we have the right price point. And GE said that we don't really have a product and we don't quite really know how to engineer it, to innovate it, to make sure that it works for you. So this discussion went on not just for energy, but for GE healthcare. And it went out, and we presented to our CEO, Jeff Immelt, and said that, sir, what are we going to do about this? And Jeff Immelt heard us, and he said, and not just us, but our counterparts in China and other businesses as well, and said that we really need the best minds working on this. So at that time, GE's training programs instituted what's called a professor at large or professor at residence program. and we're looking at who do we get on board to solve our most important problems. And this was a really important problem. How do we do innovation across the world, and how do we make it profitable, fast, and sustainable, and then make sense globally as well? And the person, Jeff Emmett and Susan Peters, that was selected was in our midst today, Vijay Govindarajan, who was GE's first professor in residence and sort of the lead guru to help us get this outside in view on how this is really supposed to work. That work led to GE changing its culture, and when large companies change their culture, both economics changes a little bit as well as technology changes a little bit. So Vijay's influence goes a lot beyond what's written here and has permeated to large sections of people now in industry and academia. The idea of reverse innovation itself has led to a bestseller book. It's led to award-winning recognition within the Harvard Business Review and in many other communities. And with that background, I'd like to introduce the